so.
I got the job. And so we have several lectures scheduled, and we have several openings for potential future lectures. My job for all of these is to find you guys who have stories that haven't been told yet that we can organize and arrange for future lectures. The way we'll work it is that we make a videotape of the lecture. You get a copy of it for your records and posterity, and the library gets a copy of it, which we hope to be able to put titles on and some introduction to it, maybe, for future use in the library after these speakers aren't around anymore. I told them that if we wait another 50 years, the story's going to be lost. So
I expect to be around for a while.
But not for them. So without a whole lot of further ado, I'm going to get the lecture started, but I'd like to say that at the last lecture, we had two people spoke up that were involved in the Battle of Leyte Gulf. One, the navigator aboard the USS Birmingham that went to the aid of the Princeton. And that was quite a story. I read about it later in the book, The Battle of Leyte Gulf. And I found between last month and this month that the book was tremendously interesting and exciting to read. We had an overview here. You've got the details in the book. And I highly recommend that you read the book if you have any interest whatsoever in what it's about. It'll mean a lot to you. Two people spoke up. One was the person there on the Birmingham. He may end up being a future speaker for us. He's somewhat of a amateur naval historian, lives in Yardley. And the other one lives in Huntington Valley nearby here, was a PT boat skipper who argued with who was first in announcing to the headquarters where the Japanese fleet was. He took credit for the PT boat announcement. It turns out when I looked in the book, they're both right. The submarine announced the Kurita, is that it?
Yes.
Fleet, and the other one announced the one coming up through Sargano Channel, or
Strait.
So, we also have two guys here that I was able to find out about. One is an Indianapolis survivor, Don Max, from Lake Wallenpack region, and the other, Vince DeRocher, from the same area. He has a 5-foot working model of the CVE rope boat that he was on. And it, I believe, had some distinction of what, killing
13 subs.
13 subs.
22 Japanese subs in the Atlantic.
Okay, so he got Japanese subs, Atlantic and Pacific. So we've got raw material for future lectures, which so far seems like the Navy is coming forward more than anybody else. We have a soldier's story coming up in January. Nothing particularly unusual except that it's historic. From December 7th of 41, what he did from then on until he had a brief encounter with George Patton and the Battle of the Bulge. He didn't finish the thing up. He was one of the lucky survivors who got shot, I guess, and or wounded and pulled out early. So, without further ado, how about Joe, you're on. Joe Nemec.
I stated last month I was a communications officer on DE-342, the Richard Douglas Seasons, flagship of Escort Division 69. I brought a couple of pictures of actually our ship. You may want to pass around. People.
If I turn this off until you need it,
okay.
If I can figure out where there's a switch.
Oh,
yeah, I was going to do that, but switch.
The subject of the talk last month was the Battle of Leyte Gulf and the invasion of the Philippines. perhaps I should mention that some of the talks that will be given, that I'm giving and which I've given and will be given here originated from men's group at Holy Trinity Lutheran Church and in Abington. And anybody here looking for a church home, see us afterwards and sign us up. Suggested that we have a quick review of the Battle of Lady Gaul. And most of the ships started from Mandus and Yakeldy Islands and went up to Lady. And I think this is later on we're going to talk about Lingayen and then Manila. Further up would be Okinawa, which would be the main part of our talk. Second overhead. I'm going through this quickly because just if you weren't here last time, well, this is a quick overview. What happened as we went to invade the Philippines at Leyte, the Japanese figured this was a time to wipe out the American naval forces. So what they did, they had four fleets. Two were going to come to join Ishimura and Shima. They were going to join, and then Tarita was going to come through St. Marino Strait and come and then wipe out the naval forces that were in Lady Gaul. Another fleet, Ozawa, was coming down from Japan, and Ozawa's objective, Halsey, was roaming around here with the Third Fleet. Ozawa's job was to try to lure Halsey away from the Philippines so that the rest of them could come after the Seventh Fleet, which, of course, was not our major striking force. Halsey had the carriers, the new battleships, the new cruisers. These were the old ships. It was very interesting that the fire support group in Lady Gaul were the old battleships, the Pennsylvania, the Tennessee, the Maryland, the West Virginia, and the California. These were all either sunk or very much damaged in Pearl Harbor. Here we have in October the 20th is when the landing started. So the night of October the 24th and the 25th is when this battle took place. So we have these ships that Japanese felt were gone. Here we have them all ready to play a major part in the Battle of Lady Gaul. Now, Kurita had five battleships. He had the largest battleship, two of the largest battleships in the world. They have these 18-inch guns. They had 12 cruisers and 13 destroyers. This is the second. Okay, so here we have the combined fleets coming through Surigaya Strait toward Lady Gaul, and then we have Kurita coming through St. Marino Strait. Now, PT boats were able to observe these joint fleets coming through Surigaya Strait and alerted Kincaid, Oliard, these ships were approaching. Two submarines were able to be fortunate to be in the path of Kurita's ships and actually sunk two of his cruisers and also alerted Kincaid and Ollendorf to the approach of these ships. sunk and damaged, sunk a battleship and damaged a cruiser. I think that when they reported back, they said they did not see a carrier in any of this area. And of course, Halsey, Bull Halsey, and he was looking for the remaining Japanese carriers. Ozawa was able to send some of his planes down and encouraged Halsey to leave this area and go after Ozawa. There was some criticism whether Halsey did the right thing or not, leaving these ships unprotected, since he had 14 carriers, 7 battleships, about 20 cruisers, and a large number of destroyers, and he could have left some of the ships here to protect the landing forces in Lady Gulf. And that as it may, he left received a message that caused him some criticism. I think the next one. So anyhow, since Admiral Kincaid and Ollendorf was aware that these ships were approaching, and it's not too clear why they would be approaching at night, but in any case, PT boats and destroyers went after them. And Ollendorf lined up the old battleships and cruisers. This operation is called Crossing the T, where you can have your ships broadside with your guns facing as the other ships are coming up. And literally, the old battleships and cruisers were able to wipe out the ships from Shima and Nishimura. About Kurita, his job was to meet with the other fleets and come into the Gulf of Leyte. Now, we have three, we call them Taffy groups, that was our code name. Each group had six CVE, small carriers, the converted carriers, and 7 escorts, a mixture of destroyers and VEs. The purpose of the three groups was to provide air protection for the landing forces on the invasion of Leyte. Kurita came through and his ships were able to go like 30 knots. We're talking about ships able to go maybe 15 to 17 knots. And so the three Taffy groups are trying to pull away from Kurita, having these 5 super battleships. What happened, only destroyers and escorts made smoke first, and then they made torpedo runs on the battleships, and we lost 3 destroyers and 1 VE, and two of the carriers. We don't know why Kurita changed his mind. He was in a position to wipe out all these ships and perhaps even to come into Lady Gulf. He changed his mind and retreated. In summary of the battle, Halsey went after Ozawa and wiped out the 4 carriers that he had. And in summary of the battle, the Japanese lost all 4 of their remaining aircraft carriers, 6 battleships, 10 cruisers, 12 destroyers, and hundreds of airplanes. As we said last time, this was the largest naval battle in history. We lost one large carrier, that was the Princeton, and we lost 2 CVEs, the small carriers. We lost 1 cruiser, the Honolulu, 3 destroyers, 1 DE, and that's the DE in our division, the Robert. members of the Japanese, Japanese Imperial Headquarters who refused to believe that they were losing the war. They felt that the only way that they could lose the war if the American Navy could be destroyed, you know, they could lose if the Navy maintained its particular strength. So they had to come up with a strategy that weakened the American Navy so that we would not be in a position to invade the mainland. There was this small group who actually believed this, and the others in the Imperial Headquarters thought that if they came up with this kind of a strategy, perhaps it would cause the United States to negotiate and modify the peace treaty. They were concerned that we might insist that they do something about getting rid of the emperor. Now, if we go back to the 13th century, we have the Mongols. These guys were really fierce fighters. They were running all over the known world. And just about defeating everybody except the island empire of Japan. And so the Kublai Khan, the Mongol emperor, he got thousands of ships together, loaded them up with all his warriors, and were heading for Japan. Just as they were embarked, ready to go about halfway from the mainland over to Japan, a very severe typhoon came and just wrecked all these ships, killed all the warriors. And the Japanese felt that the gods had saved, the divine wind had come up, and this divine wind was a kamikaze. So here we have 7 centuries later, the concept of a kamikaze was organized by the staff of the people in Japan. The strategy then was to send planes to make suicide attacks on United States ships and wipe out these ships, one plane per ship, and they had enough planes, they figured, that they could minimize the strength of the United States Navy. Now, the first kamikaze attack that was successful was on October the 25th in the Battle of Leyte Gulf. And Taffy, we saw the three Taffy groups, Taffy 1, the southern one, the St. Lowe, the CBE, was sunk, and several other ships were hit. Now, during the latter part of 1944, there were quite a number of kamikaze attacks, and many men were killed and wounded, and a large number of ships were damaged. And it caused a lot of concern, so that MacArthur and Nimitz got together and they enforced a news blackout so that there would not be panic back in the United States, and also they didn't want the Japanese to learn how successful their tactic was. Now, after the Leyte campaign, our ship participated in the invasion of Luzon up at Lingayen Gulf. This was in the northern island of the Philippines. And it was our first encounter with kamikaze. We shot down one plane and two others splashed close to the ship. And what happened when you painted these little flags on the ship? If you shot down one, you took credit for that, and if one landed close to you, you took credit for that one too. So we got three for that particular operation. We later moved down to participate in the invasion near Manila, and at that suicide boats. I don't know that that we were actually involved with them. Oh, this shows the nine doll, and now we have vanilla. Now, as the Philippine operation was being completed, our leaders again were thinking about where should the next move be. Admiral King in Washington, he wanted to attack and invade Formosa, which is now Taiwan, because he felt that we ought to be supporting the Chinese. But he lost out. Nimitz and the others selected Okinawa as the next stepping place. Okinawa is less than 400 miles from the southern part of Japan. It would be a good starting place for any future operations that would take place later for the invasion of Japan. So the invasion of Okinawa is scheduled to start on Easter Sunday, April the 1st. Early in March, in preparation for this invasion, Admiral Spruance. Now, last time we talked about Halsey in the 3rd Fleet. Now we have Spruance and the 5th Fleet. Actually, they're the same fleet. All that they did was change admirals and then change the number of the fleet and the various task forces. Now we have Admiral Spruance in Task Force 58. Here again, we have 17, I mean, we've got super carriers now. The Japanese don't have any. 17 carriers, 6 battleships, 14 cruisers, and 58 destroyers. He went and attacked the airfields in both Formosa and Kyushu, the southern island of Japan, and destroyed more than 500 Japanese planes. The idea here was to wipe out as many of the Japanese planes as possible before the actual invasion. Now to counter this, about 200 Japanese planes attacked Spruance's group and seriously damaged 2 of the carriers. Didn't sink them, but damaged them and took them out of action. That was the Franklin and the Wasp. Both of these made their way back to the States to be repaired. In this operation, the Japanese, even though they damaged these carriers, they lost 160 planes. Now, about this time, we estimated that the Japanese still had over 4,000 planes. So if you're talking about a plane, a ship, there's still lots of opportunity for the Japanese to go after our ships. Now our ship, the D-342, was assigned part of the task force that was to be part of the fire support group. We went to the islands to the west of Okinawa, Karama, Reda, and before we went to Okinawa, because of our experience at Lingai, and our captain felt we needed more firepower, and I don't know how he arranged this, but he was able to get 6 twin 50 caliber guns attached to our ship so that we would have a little more firepower for what we anticipated problems with kamikazes. So near the end of March, this fire support group, these old battleships again, start shelling the beaches in western Okinawa. And then on April the 1st, Easter Sunday, the invasion started. There was 550,000 Marines and soldiers landing on the beaches. There were 1,600 ships in the invasion armada. Now, in firepower, troops, and tonnage, it eclipsed the more famous D-Day invasion of Normandy, but I don't think there's much attention paid to this. After the invasion was underway, we and about 20 other destroyers and DEs were sign between Okinawa and Japan on screening and picket duty to give early radar warning to the ships in the harbor, to provide anti-submarine service, and also anti-suicide boat duty. While my objective is to discuss the Navy role at Okinawa, I'll briefly review the land operation. The initial landings were smooth, partly because there was so much fire support. The island is about 60 miles long and goes from maybe 2 miles to 18 miles wide. So the ships were able to really handle an area like this with the battleships. Also, the Japanese anticipated our invasion of Okinawa. So the Okinawans were big on tombs and cemetery plots where the Japanese took over, dug holes and caves, and really set themselves up further away from the invasion beaches. So it was quite a struggle for the army and Marines, only not the Marines, to advance step by step down the island. 2 days before the end of the battle, we're moving quickly through the battle. But 2 days before the end of the battle, General Buckner, who was in charge of the land forces, was killed. And I guess you do some things like this. You name a bay after him, so the bay in Okinawa is called Buckner Bay. And on the final day, after the Japanese were being pushed right to the end of the island, the two generals had a big ceremony, and in this ceremony, with their normal gowns and samurai warriors, they committed harikari, and that was the end of the battle for Okinawa, the land battle. Actually, this was the last land battle, we didn't know at the time, of World War II. He said that April the 1st is when the invasion started. On April the 6th, another group of 100 Japanese planes attacked Spruance's task force, damaged two more of our carriers, and then another 200 kamikaze planes made their way into the harbor where all the ships were at Okinawa, and they blew up two of our large ammunition ships, sank 3 DEs, and damaged 13 other ships. So there was considerable activity with the kamikazes. We mentioned that Kurita escaped with the battleship Yamato. This was the most powerful battleship in the world. It survived this Battle Lady Gulf and made its way back to Japan. She had, as I said before, 9 of these 18-inch guns, and they had a range of 20 to 30 miles. She became part of, I say she, I guess this is what we call ships, but anyhow, she became part of the kamikaze effort. So they took the battleship, one cruiser, and 8 destroyers, set out with only enough fuel to make a one-way trip to Okinawa. Japan was starting to hurt for fuel, for oil. They had no resources, and our submarines were doing a great job in keeping their ships from making the way from South Pacific back to Japan. But anyhow, the battleship and the cruiser and the 6 destroyers left Japan on April the 6th. The mission was to destroy as many of the American troop ships in the harbor and the supply ships, and then beach themselves, and then provide the artillery to help the army as they would fight off the American troops. As they were leaving Japan, Admiral Ozawa read to the men, "Render this operation the turning point of the war." The men gave three banzais for the emperor and sang the national anthem. And something may be lost in the translation, but it goes like this. Across the sea, corpses in the water. Across the mountain, corpses in the field. I shall die for the emperor. I shall never look back. Now, one of our submarines was close to Japan and was able to note this group leaving Japan and alerted Admiral Spruance. He sent his planes after this group, and we had about 400 planes attacking the group in waves of maybe 50 airplanes at a time. And the report is that about 2 hours, all the ships were sunk. So it takes care of this particular suicide mission. Now, the air superiority is increasing almost daily. We have the Thunderbolts coming in, and the Corsairs, and so the Navy and the Marines and the Air Force were doing a great job. But the good coverage was for the daytime. So the Japanese became aware of this and changed their kamikaze missions to sunrise and sunset when the our planes would go away. The Japanese kamikaze planes would come both to the escorts above Okinawa and mainly trying to get into the anchorage where the supply ships. When we think of the magnitude of the number of troops on Okinawa, supplies that were necessary, and we're talking about logistics here, where we're talking about a distance of about over 7,000 miles from the United States to bring all the supplies that are necessary for an operation like this. There was a lot of activity in the harbor area. Supply ships were coming in all the time, bringing all the things that were munitions, food, all kinds of supplies. What was happening, the ships coming in would be coming in with either ships from escort ships, destroyers or VEs from the Atlantic, or new ships. And then they would return, the empty supply ships would be returning to the States with the beat up ships that the kamikazes had damaged. And then the ships coming in would then be replacing them, and I don't know if they were looking forward to the duty as picket duty above Okinawa. I have a brief aside here that we were talking about April 44, that on April the 12th, President Roosevelt died. Japanese thought that this would have a larger impact on our activities than it actually did. And, 6 days later, the GI favorite correspondent, Ernie Pyle, was killed. He was one who followed the troops from invasion to invasion and was very close to the GI soldier. As the kamikaze problem became more and more of a severe, we increased our bombing. We now have B-29s and of course other planes bombing the Japanese airfields, and then we were moving into the Japanese cities, and we have the firebombing of Tokyo, which actually in the long run resulted in more damage and death than the atom bomb. call me, you know, I volunteered, so, but I didn't volunteer with the thought that I was going to be on a suicide mission. Now, here we have about 3,000 people volunteering for to be kamikaze pilots. These were mostly young, inexperienced people. They didn't need a whole lot of training. You just had to learn how to take off. You didn't have to learn how to land. Now, early in the history of Japan, there was a belief in the divinity of the emperor. And perhaps many of these people felt that the sacrifice that they were making would lend them some special points in the hereafter. Then there was also many shrines in Japan where the shrines would be for relatives, and they would, young people would have great respect for their relatives, and they would feel perhaps that volunteering for a mission like this would also cause them some special reward in the next life. There's also a big ceremony involved with the kamikazes. They would wine and dine them. These people were you a hero before? Well, anyhow, they were treating them as if they were heroes, even though they probably weren't going to be returned. And frequently, there was lots of partying and wining and dining and sake toast, sometimes perhaps too much sake, and some of them didn't do as well. Now, our ship, the PE-342, was in the Okinawa area from about the middle of March to the end of June. This was not a very happy time. We were on this picket duty at the port of Okinawa. There was a considerable strain anticipating these kind of attacks. There were days when we didn't get a lot of sleep. Our captain went to the idea after we figured out that the problems were more related with sunrise and sunset. The sunset, that we would have routine general quarters right before sunrise and right before sunset. And you may have, depending on how many bogeys the radar was picking up, we might stay at general quarters for 4 or 5 hours. My position at general quarters was officer of the deck. The captain would be there to take over, and this meant that we had a position to maintain, and you had all these other jobs as officer of the deck. It would sometimes be you would complete one watch, and then you would go to routine general quarters, and so it would be a long period. It wasn't a very happy time. I think of the poor people in the engine rooms. These were people who would get some word from a talker saying that some planes were approaching or this is what happening and all this business. And DEs had, I don't know how thin the armor was, but there wasn't much protection, particularly for the people below decks. And the engineers were pretty much concerned about, they always wanted to know what's happening. We shot down 7 planes and perhaps got vetted for 4 near misses. And I think the 7 that, most of the 7 were probably from guys that hadn't had too much flight experience. I think it was early on, kamikaze pilots, some of them would come from way up, come down, they would either hit the ships or come close enough to cause some damage. Others would come low on the water so that they would avoid being picked up on radar. But near the end, these guys weren't doing a very good job. And due to their inexperience. We had no serious damage. We had a couple of near misses that caused some damage. Maybe eight of our people were injured somewhat, but not seriously. And when you approach the harbor area for refueling or provision, it looked like a graveyard. It's full of ships in various stages of damage. Many had lost their masts. Others had superstructures caved in. Others had large gaping holes. And they were in a position of being patched up to be prepared so that they could escort the empty supply ships back to Pearl Harbor and to the States. Final summary of the Okinawa campaign. In the land battle, more than 150,000 Japanese were killed. About 8,000 U.S. Soldiers and Marines were killed, and perhaps 25,000 were injured. Come to the Navy, there were over 5,000 killed and about another 5,000 wounded. 36 of our ships were sunk, and 368 were damaged. We lost over 700 planes, and the Japanese lost about 3,500 planes. So you can ask the question, was the kamikaze strategy effective? Well, if their objective was to kill and wound a large number of Navy people, I don't know what number they wanted to do, but killing 5,000 and wounding another 5,000 met their objective. They wanted to sink and damage ships. They sunk 36 and damaged 368. And they disturbed and upset a lot of people who were there, and also our leaders. I guess a negative thing, it caused us to increase significantly our large-scale bombing of Japan, particularly their cities, that we weren't going solely for airfields, we were bombing Japan. And in the long run, I don't think it had any significant effect on the final surrender terms. While the Battle of Okinawa was in its final stages, spring people were formulating Operation Olympia, invasion of homeland Japan, and we scheduled this to take place on November 1st, 1945. But the following unexpected happened, at least it was unexpected to most of us. On July the 26th, the cruiser Indianapolis delivered our two A-bombs to Tinian Island. Unfortunately, 3 days later, the Indianapolis was torpedoed by a Japanese submarine and sunk. Then on August the 16th, the first A-bomb was dropped on Hiroshima, and 3 days later, the other A-bomb was dropped on Nagasaki. My understanding is that was a secondary target, but whatever, it was dropped. On August the 13th, Japan agreed to the surrender, and on September the 2nd, a peace agreement was signed on the Missouri and Tokyo Bay. The final few comments on our activities and the rest of our duty. Early September 45, we escorted several ships. Among them was the USS Sierra to Korea, Jinsen ago, we were going to be part of the fire support group for the invasion that was to take place in November. Of course, war is over. In October, Admiral Sample, who had been in charge of one of our TAFE groups, was on a seaplane and was lost. And so we went out with some of the CBEs to look for Admiral Sample. At that same time, let's say, a kamikaze type typhoon came up, and for about a week or so, we were riding out the this typhoon. This wasn't a very pleasant period. You know, we were sort of like going through this, and then when you would go into the waves, the ship would kind of bounce, and you would wonder whether it would hold together. I have another brief aside to make. After the war, I made a number of business trips to Japan. And in the early 1980s, I became very friendly with our licensing man in Japan, and we didn't talk anything about the war until we became really good friends. So I did tell him that I had spent a month in Wakayama, and he said, we're going to be close to Wakayama when we're going to visit a certain company. So he said, let's stay overnight in Wakayama. So we went there, and had this ask for somebody from the kitchen whether there was somebody who had been around at the time when the Americans came to Wakayama back in 1945. And so this older, my older, and he asked her her experiences, and she said, we were so frightened. He told us the Americans were coming, and we could expect to be beaten up, brutalized, and raped, and all the women should move to the hills, get away. And she said, it was nothing like that. Found out later that these were nice people. They were bringing cigarettes and soap and candy and bartering with us for souvenirs. And she got a job in the kitchen, and she said they didn't allow them to do the cooking, but they did the clean up and all this. And she said it was great because she said there was such a great shortage of food that stuff they were throwing away, she would just carry home and just give to the people in the village. And I read somewhere that at the time, the American soldiers were, and sailors, were the nicest people in the world. The Russians and the Japanese and the Germans, whenever they would go into any of these places, you could expect all these bad things to happen. But Americans were looking for souvenirs. In late October, we went to Tokyo Bay and then left for Long Beach, California. We went down to San Diego, and put the ship in the inactive fleet. I had gotten sort of a direct commission, so I didn't have all these points that a lot of other people had. So all the other officers left the ship, and I became captain of the ship, and actually a division commander of these other six ships, and you had all these duties about people urinating and having captain's mask and the throw beer bottles and stuff. We had to put all these ships out of commission, and this was a very good experience. I was relieved when I got enough points and detached, and my detached orders were signed by Jesse B. Ordendorf, commander. He became commandant of the 11th Navy. years later, in November 1951, I had gone back to school and got the job at Roman Haas and was working, and I got this package from the Navy, and it said, Secretary of Navy has awarded the USS Richard W. Seasons a Navy unit commendation for outstanding heroism in action against enemy Japanese aircraft, shore batteries, and submarines during the operations at Leyte, Lingayen Gulf, Manila Bay, and Okinawa operations. So that made me feel pretty good. I don't know how many. The other, I got called before I came that there was a 10-year-old going to attend tonight, and they asked whether the language would be acceptable. So, any of you want to ask any questions, you ought to make sure that there's not too much swearing. But I also, for his benefit, brought a couple of show and tell items. When we left Tokyo Bay for home, our signalmen made a going home pennant. I don't know whether other ships did this, and this was everybody on the ship got a piece of this flag, and it was, I don't know.
I mean, once we were out, had to determine how long it was.
No, each individual got a piece of this flag. How long we were out?
The pennant itself was determined by how long it was out.
Okay.
So that gives you an idea.
Okay. The other thing is a Japanese hat, you know, a couple packs of cigarettes. And as I said, we were a flagship, and I was a communications officer, and I had great signalmen. These guys were really tremendous. Whenever a flag would go up, they would be able to either get to the book quick, or they would just know immediately what it was. And they would also know when something went up, when somebody on the other ship fouled up and put up the wrong flag. So they made this flag to put up very quickly. I said, so they gave this to me as a that does it.
That looks like the box is a World War II vintage.
Yeah, I think, yeah, this is where, you know, something came to me in this box that I don't remember what, but.
Cookies and candy.
Probably with meals or whatever. Any questions or additions?
It always puzzled me when they would say a ship burned for about 4 or 5 days, which I think was the Princeton, right? Didn't it burn for many days? Why would a ship made of steel burn that long? I could never
understand. Well, there's fuel, lots of fuel. And there's lots of provisions, there's
electrical wire.
There's a lot of stuff on a ship that can burn.
Insulation.
Of course,
on the aircraft carriers, there's gasoline from the airplane.
Yeah, the Princeton, you know, there were also explosions. And I guess this is where the Birmingham came alongside, right, and to help put out the fires and help rescue people, and just tremendous explosion, and I think more people on the cruiser got injured than were injured on the carrier.
420 were killed immediately.
Yes.
And something like 269 were wounded. For the book. If you wanted to see about the Princeton burning, there's a few pages in here that was on about that.
Thank you.
I didn't know all of this, but after Joe's earlier talk, I thought I'd get transparencies made, and I was going to go to the original to get it. The hardback book doesn't have any of those maps in it. The later paperback has the maps in it. But I got the reading through here. First, I jumped through at random, picking things like the Princeton, because we had a guy that was on a much more interesting after you've heard the talk, I think, than it would have been, you know, just picking up cold. There are a lot of other books that the library has available. Last time they sorted out a number of the books and had them available down here. You could make use of that. Another thing that I did after the last talk, since we had PT boat skipper, I went onto the internet and searched the word PT boats, and I got lots of websites. And I sent Joe a copy of the listing of all of the ships in the tactic group, their skippers and their numbers. And I also had a listing of all of the PT boats that were made, what their number was, and stuff like that. There's poodles of information about that kind of stuff if you look for it a little bit.
I think we mentioned how many ships are lost and how many ships are damaged, but I think we shouldn't forget there are a lot of people involved. There are people who are not only killed and injured, and then some have some problems that still exist with them.
About it, unless somebody will talk some more on that. We've got a little bit of time.
I think the 40s and the 20s probably were the most effective. We had, on the bridge, you had talkers to the engine rooms, you had talkers to the lookouts, you had talkers to various guns and, you know, all this business.
When you say talkers, is that a tube?
Oh, these were individuals with little phones, you know, communicating.
Sound power.
So the captain and I, you know, there'd be a kamikaze we know is approaching, and you know, we're running on this side, and there's a talker getting tangled in with the wires, so we came up with something. This isn't a big word. We call it the whole ass bill, where it meant if we don't need these talkers to talk to the engine room. What we need is enough room on the bridge so that we can maneuver. And so this was a good target for a kamikaze plane, the bridge area, and since this was here where I was, I didn't want to be tangled up with sound-powered wires.
Did you ever run into any of the typhoons that they had out there?
Yeah, I mentioned that the typhoon that we had at the end when we were looking for our little sample, and many of the ships in Buckner Bay and in that area were damaged by the typhoon, and I didn't feel too. I felt when we were a submarine. Sometimes we were with these other ships, and there's a time when you couldn't see this other ship. We were going up and down, and a couple of times.
How high were the waves? I've seen 50-foot waves.
Oh my gosh!
I've seen where I can look under the bow, and then you're looking way up at a wave.
You have to be careful, you know, the ship like this, if you start going too far over, you could go like this. So if
if you're getting close to this angle, then you start going into the waves. And the problem with this is the ship would go up and then bounce. And I didn't feel too secure about got all this bouncing.
Okay, you can imagine. This is 90 degrees and this is 45. This is 60 degrees. And we had a 62 degree difference in a typhoon and in sea to face for 3 days. This way and that way. Everything was hung off of the overhead.
That's enough to make you seasick, isn't it?
Yeah. No, actually, you don't get seasick at this.
No, you don't?
No, it's a gradual movement.
Try walking when you come ashore after. Yeah.
Jerry has a book that's called Halsey's Typhoon. Their code names were Cobra and Viper. And they really went through a lot, especially the tin cans, because they were rolling 90 degrees. Well, matter of fact, yes. You can imagine sloshing, well, rolling 75 degrees and water's coming down the funnels and fuel spilling all over. And this wasn't a very happy cruiser.
This was a heavy cruiser. I mean, 10,000 tons.
Well, he was on a DE.
Yeah, we were
on a DE.
You were worse than that.
That's like a canoe in a windstorm.
I think you got a soldier over here, haven't you?
Yeah, I wasn't in the Navy. I was in the 7th Army. I was in the invasion. When they had the April 1st invasion,
okay.
I was there in the middle of it. And the Marines went north, and the Army, 7th Army went south.
That's where all the Japanese were, south.
They had two airfields, at Yantan and Kadena, and they just blew them all out of the water. There was nothing left of them. But you were talking about kamikaze planes. I was on guard duty one night when the kamikaze planes came in and dropped parachutists in with hand grenades all around them. And if you shot one boy, you saw him splatter all over the place. They didn't mess around. It wasn't just the planes, they were sending people in.
Well, yeah, there's suicide, you know, the kamikaze philosophy. You had the planes,
they dropped,
you talked about the battleship, you had the small boats, and then we had individual swimmers, actually, that were supposed to swim the ships and attach themselves.
Up at Grand Marais. The word was, if you saw anything floating on the surface of the water, you shot it. Because they used pizza baskets, cardboard boxes, whatever, over their heads, and they were loaded with dynamite. They swim out to the side of the ship, and away it goes.
This book on Okinawa that I researched said the Marines went north to secure an air, or fix an airfield, to be used,
right.
And as the bulldozers were working, a Japanese plane came in and landed. The pilot got out, threw off his, and walked over. And then the Marine shot him. Some poor bastard. Somebody, you know, it's only somebody doesn't get the word.
My brother-in-law had been with USS Dutchess. It was a 98. What was a 98? Is that a? They have a history of the ship, but I don't
know. They have a name.
It was USS Dutchess, and under
Dutchess.
ADA 98. It was from August of 44 to March of 46. And after the war was over, he took duty one night, and he was struck by lightning during one of those storms.
98. That was an attack transport.
Yeah,
it
was a
transport.
AKA is an attack transport. AKA is an attack transport.
An attack transport. Okay.
Basically, it destroyed.
So it's a troop transport.
Yeah.
And it would have these landing ships that the troops would climb down the netting, get on it. That's what
it was. Merriweather.
Yeah.
It wasn't much of a Merriweather. That was our ship. And when we left. We were in Leyte, and when we left Leyte, we didn't have any boat drills or anything like that. And the skipper of the ship came on the intercom, and he said, in case you wonder why we're not having lifeboat drills, he said, this ship is loaded with high-octane gasoline. He said, and you won't need a lifeboat. He said, you need a parachute. I'll never forget that man.
going from Lady to Okinawa?
Yeah. We started in July. We were on the ship 23 days. But we went to Leyte and then we went to Okinawa.
I was wondering if the kamikazes, did they all carry a bomb?
Yes.
They started out that way, and near the end, and actually they had some that had carried a mobile kind of a bomb that they could not just drop, but vodka or something.
Yeah, yeah. Guidance
bomb. But near the end, I guess as they were running out of planes and bombs, there were fewer. But they originally started out this way, and this is what caused, I think, the serious problems with the large aircraft carriers. That
they also used shells as a bomb. They crashed, you know, like a shell to the plane and just crashed it anyway.
In the book, Battle of Leyte Gulf, it mentioned 220 kilogram bombs, which would be about 500 pound bombs, is what they started with.
See, I have this problem. I can see if I'm on the top of a hill and somebody says, run down and fight with these people and maybe do everything you can to save your country. Even then, I may have second thoughts. But here you're flying 500 miles in a plane. You keep your
looking forward to the end.
Looking forward to the end. You know, it's not like 15 minutes or something like this. You have hours.
Well, they weren't allowed to return to the refuge.
I know they weren't.
They had enough. If they didn't hit a ship or whatever, they were just abandoned in the middle.
The people were volunteering for this. They were lined up.
Exactly.
Hey, I'm a patriot, do all this, but lining up for something.
You mentioned the early kamikazes came in low. They seemed to have a tactic. What were they doing later when they didn't have that tactic anymore? You had less experienced flyers.
That was the problem. Huh? They would just fly in, and
come down straight down.
I don't think they had experienced pilots. For the beginning, they selected pilots. They wanted to keep their good pilots for return trips. And they had less experienced pilots volunteer for it right from the beginning, according to what I read.
Actually, they had experienced pilots who would fly fighter planes to sort of escort them to an area and try to fight off our attack planes. Sort of protect them so that they could then do their suicide mission.
And also
in some cases,
near
the end,
to report back what happened. Oh, yeah. They wanted to make sure.
I think the reports, I don't know if all pilots do this, but the reports were generally grossly exaggerated, so the people back in the Imperial office felt that this was more successful.
They thought they were winning the war.
Yes.
I was stationed in Japan on a base called Iwakuni. I don't know if any of you have ever heard of Iwakuni. It's just south of Hiroshima, about 27 kilometers south of Hiroshima. And on the base we had, Iwakuni was the starting point of Admiral Nishi, was the admiral that was in charge of gathering all the people to train them for the suicide missions. And being stationed in Japan, I really got interested in this because we had bunkers in Iwakuni on the base itself where they used to keep the Japanese Zeros. It was concrete bunkers, reinforced concrete bunkers. And out in town and up in the mountains, they had concrete bunkers where they would keep the airplanes. So I started reading up while I was out there. And you said you didn't understand the mentality. You have to understand that, first of all, it's a different culture. It's not an American culture, it's an Oriental culture, and they believe in different things. And to them, there's a temple up north called Yakusuni. And Yakusuni was the temple where all the divine women and all the gods went to and the emperor went to. And to them, if they died in combat, this was the mentality of the Japanese guys, if they died in combat as a kamikaze, they would go to Yakasuni to meet with the emperor and live with all the emperors that came before Hirohito. And the whole thing was, it was the Bushido code, the code of the warrior. And if you really want to understand it, it's kind of very heavy reading. If you want to understand the Japanese kamikaze, you have to read several books. One's called The Divine Wind, and the other one's called some Thunder Gods. Thunder Gods and Divine Wind is all about the Japanese Zero pilots. And the mission of the Yamamoto, the Yamato, there's a book written by a gentleman that was on the Yamato. And, you know, we think of it, okay, the Japanese, they're the enemy, they did this and they did that and everything. But you got to remember, some of these people were family. They didn't want nothing to do with the war either, but they had to be there. And this gentleman wrote this book, and he was on the Yamato when they made the suicide mission to Okinawa. And the book is called Requiem for a Battleship. It's all about the Yamato and the run that they made. One-way fuel, they told him it was one way, and exactly like you said, after we go in between all the American ships and sink what we could sink, then we're going to beach them. Everybody's going to be handed a rifle. You jump off the ship and go help the army guys on land. But their whole idea, the whole mentality of the kamikaze was to die gallantly, and then go on to Yakasuni, to the shrine, and be with the emperor. And this was a great thing for them. And that's why we hated them. We hated them because they shot our people out of the, you know, we would have, our pilots would parachute out of their burning airplane, and they would, you know, the Japanese would come right behind them and shoot them down. We didn't do that. But to them, their mentality was different. That was the enemy. Kill them, if this is war, and let's kill them whichever way we could kill them. And they have a lot of things, you know, like the Betty Bomber. The Betty Bomber carried that Oka, which we're talking about, what they call the Okabaka Bomb. Okabaka means very foolish in Japanese. And they carried the Okabaka Bomb, which was strapped underneath this bomber, this, you know, medium-range bomber. And the bomber would go out, and so many miles out from the ships in the bay there, they would drop the Okabaka, and hopefully that this thing, at first it was unpowered, it was a glider. And then towards the end, they were actually playing around with like a rocket-powered version of the same thing, the Okabaka, where they would light the rocket off, and it would just aim and just slam itself right into the ship. Nothing. All it was strapped underneath the airplane. And they ran out of those fast. And then another thing that they used out there was a cape, which was a two-man sub. And a lot of the I-boats, the Japanese I-boat, which was, at the time, some of the big submarines in the world. They were bigger than the Germans, bigger than the Americans. And this I-boat could carry airplanes on board in the hangar on the deck. And it could also carry something like 8 capes on board. And they would surface at night and the I-boat, the I-Suri boats. The capes. Yeah. The capes were little submarines that would carry about 2 or 3personnel on board. And these would be strapped on the deck of this other submarines. There were many submarines. And they would take these submarines, put them in the water, and then they go. And adios, you know, have a good one, and we'll see you in Yakasuna.
How about making sure the torpedoes?
Yeah, that's what it was. Yeah, it was a torpedo with a little conning tower on it, with only 2 people on board, and then we guided them.
Attention, please. The library is closing in 30 minutes. Their office machines will be turned off in 15 minutes. Thank you.
We have about 15 minutes more to go before we're out of here. But if I can, let's hold off on further this discussion for just a moment. I was wondering, Vince, could you just give us a quick rundown of what it is that you've got? We may have Vince DeRocher talking to us at a future meeting, hopefully.
Well, I have a model of my ship that I was on. 5'3". It's fully operational. I bring it to you, reunions and things like that. But if I gave a story, it would be the story of the USS Bold. It was the first CVE in the Atlantic. It had the biggest run-up of submarines. It sank the only 2 Japanese subs in the Atlantic. After we finished the war with Germany, VE Day, we were still out in the Atlantic sinking U-boats. From there, we went out to the Pacific out there, we did mostly transport duty, bringing planes to the fleet carriers, bringing people who were coming back to the States. We did very few wounded people, but mostly people that had a long time out there we brought back. And I'll be bringing my carrier down here to show you. I can show you different, like my gun position, where I slept, where my cleaning station was. I was only a seaman, but I can show you what the different things I did on the ship. Like if he had a model of his, he could show you exactly what he was talking about. And he did show you the pictures of it, which is very good. And that basically it. And my friend here, he was on the Indianapolis, and he had a story.
I was on Indianapolis for 3.5 years, and I was a bugle master on the ship. They don't use those today. They use tapes and VCRs. They put us out of this. But anyhow, they found out I was a musician. At one time, I had my own orchestra in the Poconos. And they sent me to a bugle school in San Diego. From there, I went on to Indianapolis and was on until the time she was sunk on the 30th of July, 1945. I spent 4 days and 5 nights in the Pacific before I was picked up with the USS Conan Doyle, the destroyer. And it was an experience, and I'll have to go back and rewind my tape and see what I can gather to come down if I get elected to talk to you people about it.
Did you make a book out, The Abandoned Ship?
Yes, there are 5 books out. The Abandoned Ship is one by Richard C. Newcomb. One called All the Lost Sailors, and there are 5 books altogether.
Did you have any experience with the sharks?
Pardon?
Did you have any experience with the sharks? I know that they...
Fortunately, I got about as close to them as from me to you. Mm-hmm. That was close enough.
Did they shoot up a lot of guys?
Shoot them up a lot. The thing was, most of the fellas that were injured and got in the water with an injury, blood is like a magnet to a shark. They'll go after it, and they'll go. They can smell it for miles.
And your captain committed suicide?
Yes, he did.
He was unjustly accused?
Yes, he was.
What was his fault?
He was. There's quite a story behind it, and I'll tell you about it when I have more time. I'm going to take up.
Okay. Thanks a lot, Don. Next month, Howard Fry is going to tell us about a different part of the war. Could you give us a 2-minute brief preview, or could you do that?
I don't know about a 2-minute preview, but something like that. It's certainly a different aspect of World War II that I will present to you. Less spectacular, believe me. I was very fortunate in my duty section, and Brazil and the South Atlantic were strategic areas, but very quiet compared to what you heard about Leyte and Okinawa, and Don and his B-17, and the infantry in Germany and France. And it will be the strategy of the Germans with respect to submarines, submarine warfare, in the Atlantic from 1941 until 1945. Submarines were still active on the last day of the war. They sank one ship on the last day before Germany surrendered. And then later that day, that submarine was sunk. So, thank you.
And Don, give us a quick preview on what happened to you. Don Lewis, this will be about April, I guess, won't it?
Yes.
Okay.
Well, in April, I'll give a little talk. It won't be as far-reaching G.I. Joe's.
It's your story.
Story. I was a full turret gunner on a B-17. Flew missions out of North Africa and later out of Italy. Bombed Messerschmitt plants, railroad yards, and viaducts and bridges. And on our 13th mission, we didn't make it home. And we'll go into more detail.
He just mentioned about the DE that was sunk at the last day of the war. Mm-hmm. That was the Frederick Davis. We had the survivors from Davis. We had the survivors from the submarine. Mm-hmm. And we gave up our beds because we were next to the sick bay. Mm-hmm. How about that? There's a lot of cross-play and interconnections here. Last month I mentioned the two others that were at the Battle of Leyte Gulf. I'd like to get some of you who have stories to, before you leave, let me have your name and phone number so I can talk to you later. I may not be able to work you in. You may not want to talk, but it may be that somehow we can get your story into what we're doing here. Anybody else in the next few minutes have something to say? This is an interesting part of it to me, is to hear what everybody else has to say, too. Any suggestions for future meetings that you have in mind? Well, it's like we've come to the end. All right. Thank you.